The One World Combinatorics on Words seminar. Before we get started, I just want to mention that the website for the seminar is currently down. We are aware of the problem, and we'll hopefully it will be fixed as soon as possible. But we are aware that that the website is currently down right now. I would like to welcome our speaker for today, Simon Stankiewicz. He is going to speak to us today about square-free redux of words. Go ahead, Simon.
Yeah, hello, everyone. So yeah, just like Nalat said, my name is Szymon Stankiewicz. I will present my joint work with Jarosław Gryczuk, which I believe already had some presentation on this seminar at the beginning. I will talk about square-free redux of words. So yeah, let's start with some definitions. Let me just move it here. Okay. I assume that everyone here knows what a square is. So the goal of these reductions is to start with any word which can have a squares in it. Can maybe it doesn't have any squares in it and it's square free already, but after this reduction we want to go into the we want to finish in the world in a square free world. So one thing that the obvious thing we can do is just pick any square and remove half of it to get a shorter word without this square. Obviously, and just like I think we'll see it later. You can generate new squares after removing some squares, but our goal is just to reduce it in this way, as long as there are any squares in the world. So that's exactly what the first definition says. So we can reduce word W into word U in one step when the word W has a square BB and in the word U we have only one B. So we change ABBC to ABC. That's something that we can do only that we are doing only in one step, but we can. I think I have a feedback from somebody because I can hear myself. Okay, anyway, so we can just like I said, we can repeat this operation for a few times as long as we have a square, and. We will say that a word W can be square reduced into word U. When we can reduce word W into word U, not only in one step but maybe in few steps. But at least in this case, since we are talking only about the finite words, we are talking only about the finite number of reductions. And yeah, it's obvious that this relation this weird arrow is a transitive and reflexive closure of relation above, because we want to add the information that we can reduce a word to itself, but for any other words, any other part of the words, we will define it as just a sequence of reductions. And U is a reduct of a word W if and only if we can reduce W to U, and U is a square free word. And a few helpful functions that we will use later in this presentation. R of W is the set of reducts of the word W, the bigger. The small r is the size of this set. And we'll use the function fk of n defined as maximal value of R of W over all words of length N over alphabet of size K. Maybe it will get a little bit clearer later when we will use it for the first time, but just heads up right now. Okay, so quick example. We can have a really simple word, AB to the power of 5. And you can see that in one step, we can reduce AB to the power of 5 into AB to the power of 4 by removing the last AB because we have a square ABAB. We can also do it to reduce the word into an even shorter word, so to the AB to the power of 3. But important thing is that sometimes there is more than one way which will reduce the in which there is more than one way in which we can reduce a word into another word in one, even in one step. Just like you can see here, we can reduce square ABAB, but we can also reduce square BABA. On both of these cases, we'll get the same word. Those two words, so AB to the power of 4 and AB to the power of 3, are the only words that we can obtain by reducing AB to the power of 5 in only one step. But if we add the possibility to do multiple steps, we can reduce it to AB to the power of 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5 if we won't do anything. But in this case, AB is the only reduct of AB to the power of 5 because AB is the only square free word that we can obtain from AB to the power of 5. Maybe somehow more interesting case because we have a word which you can see here. We can reduce it in one step to square free word ABC BABC. So we have one reduct, but we can reduce it in some other way. So we, just like you can see here, we are always removing the red part of the word during the reduction. We can reduce it to the other word, other square free word, other reduct ABC. So this word has two reducts, which wasn't the case for the previous example. So natural question after that is to ask how many reducts can a word have, right? So let's start with something pretty simple. So we can prove that if we take any binary word, then this word W would have only one reduct. And proof is pretty straightforward because there is infinitely many, and in reality, only 6 square free binary words. 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1. And there is another important thing about this reduction is that when we are doing any reductions, the first letter of the word doesn't change, the last letter of the word also doesn't change, and the set of the letters in the word also doesn't change. So if there is a letter A in any place of the word, we cannot reduce it to any word which doesn't contain A. So as you can see, if we take a look at this three properties, we can distinguish this 6 square free binary words, right? So if we take any two of them, they will have different first letters, different last letters, or different set of the words, different set of the letters. So naturally, we cannot reduce the word to two different square-free binary words because of this second property, right? So so it's a pretty straightforward case. It's getting a little bit more interesting for words over alphabet of three, of size three, because here we can prove that for every integer k, there exists a ternary word w which has at least k redux. Actually, I will show you two different proofs of that. The second proof would be even a little bit stronger. But I think even the first proof is interesting. So we can take these four words. It's really not important to think a lot about those words. It's the more important thing is the relation between those words. We can start with defining a morphism, which changes A into word A, B into word B, and C into word C. And we can prove that this morphism is square free. So yeah, just a quick recap. So morphism is square free. If and only if, when we take any square free word and apply this morphism to this word, we will get a square free word for any square free word over this given alphabet. And there is a result of Crutchmore. I'm not sure about the pronunciation, but it's enough to check if all square free words of length at most three it's enough to check for only for the square free words of length at most three if when we apply this morphism to this words, the result would be also square free. It's because maybe I will come back to this slide. As you can see, all of those words has the same length. It's important for this result. But yeah, we can do only that. And you can do it by hand. You can run a script to check it out. And we've done it, and it turned out that it's true that this morphism is a square free morphism. And obviously, we can define second morphism, which is just a swap of the values for A and B. It's obvious that if the above morphism is square free, then the morphism phi second is also a square free morphism. Okay, so let's dig a little bit more into what's happening between those letters, between those words. So the first important thing is that we can reduce D into A and D into B. It's just a description of how this reduction looks like. You can check it by yourself, but it's not something that we should take a longer look at. But the important thing is here. We can define the third morphism, which translates A into D, B into D, and C into C. And since we can reduce D into A and D into B, we know that if we take any ternary word W and we apply this this morphism to this word, we can reduce the result into two different words. One word which is a result of applying morphism psi over for W, and the other one is the second morphism that we defined previously. I think it's pretty straightforward, but just to give you a quick description why we can do this is why we can do this. Okay, we can do it because if we take a look at the result word, we can, for now, we can ignore all the squares that are not the squares inside of words D or C, and we will reduce only those parts because we can reduce only some part of the word and ignore the rest and just don't touch it for now. So yeah, so we can reduce this for each block D we can reduce this block into A or B and don't touch for now anything else. So we can do it as we want. Obviously, there are also some other words that we can obtain, because for example, if we would have a morphism which translates A into A, B into A, and C into C, there's also something that we can that we can mimic, right? Because we can reduce all these to the A's and not just part of them to the B and part of them to the A. But we won't need any information about those words to show the results that we want to show. And also here, if we can reduce U to W and we apply any morphism towards U and W, then the results of applying this morphism, there is a reduction between the results of these morphisms, of applying these morphisms. We may conclude that if we take any reduct of the word W and apply any square-free morphism to this reduct, the result of this of applying this morphism would be a reduct of the word which we get by applying this morphism to the starting word from which we obtain this reduct. It's obvious because just like I mentioned a second ago, applying these morphisms is not removing any relation between those two objects, and so we know that we can reduce let's call it a phi. If we know that T is a reduct of S, we know that we can reduce chi of S to chi of T. And since chi is a square-free morphism, we know that chi of T is a square-free word, so we know that this word is a reduct of chi of S. So now we can show that if we take any ternary word containing one of letters A or B, at least one, obviously we can just take a word which has only A's and B's, we can show that the number of reducts after applying these morphisms to this word is at least two times bigger than before applying it. And yeah, and yeah, so the first thing is that if S and T are different words, then applying those two morphisms won't result in getting the same word. It's obvious because this the main reason why it's the case is because all of those words have the same length, so we can just take a look at the blocks of this length, and we can have an inverse function which would produce the original word S, so there can't be equal. And if S is containing at least one letter E or B, then result of applying first morphism is different than applying the second morphism. It's also pretty straightforward because we can find a block which corresponds to first occurrence of letter A and B and take a look at this block. And we know that if we apply the first one, this block would be a word A. To make it easier, let's say that the first occurrence is A. So if we take a look at the first occurrence of A, then if we applied the first morphism, this block would be equal to word A. But if we applied the second one, this word would be equal to this block would be equal to word B. So based on that, we can deduce which morphism we used. So, and also these two functions are, these two words needs to be, have to be different. So based on that, we know that if we take any reduct of word W, let's call it S, then we will get, we can produce two different new words, which cannot be generated by any other reduct of W. The first one is word S after applying the first morphism, and second one is after applying the second morphism. And since those two words are square free, because we proved it previously, then those new words are reducts of the new word obtained by applying the morphism toward the W. Those two words are different, and they are also different than words generated by different by other reducts of word W. So we generated at least two reducts for each reduct of word S. So we increased the size of the number of reducts of this new word. So we generated at least two times more reducts in the new word than in previous one. Obviously, just like I said before, we can generate some other words, because for example, we ignored the case when we generate reduce all D's to A's and all C's to C's, and then we move to some next we starting to obtain a redux from this place, but yeah, we just want to show that it's at least two times more, so it's enough to show this case, and we can ignore the other cases, it's enough to show that we can have a word that the number of reducts is not limited in the language over the words of the ternary alphabet. But there is a second thing that we can prove it. Because we can prove that there are words of length n containing that has at least c to the power of n reducts. Alpha to the n of, or maybe, oh, this one, that we can show that there are some ternary words of length n which contains at least, which has at least alpha to the power of n redux. So yeah, if we can show this, then we are getting the previous result for free. And to prove it, we will use the first fact. So we will we'll use the fact that the number of square free words of length n over a three letter alphabet is at least c to the power of n, and this constant c is roughly 1.3. But yeah, we can use exactly the same word, the same words as previously. We'll use the words c and d, and we'll just take c d d d, and we will reply it. We will repeat it n times. And obviously, since d can be reduced to a or b, we can reduce it to all binary square free words which are using the alphabet A and B, big A and big B. WM can be reduced to any square free word over alphabet ABC, having M letters C and starting with CA or CB. Why that's the case? Because if we take an ternary square free word, then and take a look at the occurrences of a letter, then between next occurrences of the letter, let's call it C, we can have at most three letters A and B, because if we would have four, then it would mean that there is a square inside, so we cannot do it. And here we can reduce it to everything. And the number of such words is at least c to the power of m. And length of wm is at most 36 times m, because this block cddd has 36 letters. So we can show that if we take alpha equal to c to the power of 1 over, or like 36 root of c to the power of 1 over 36, then it would be a good alpha for our theorem. And since, just like I said, since c is roughly 1.3, we can calculate that alpha is bigger than 1.0073. Okay, but what's happening in the alphabet, for the alphabets of size 4? So for alphabet of size 4, we can have even a stronger result. So in this case, for each k, we can find a word which has exactly k distinct reducts. So it's stronger than previous theorem, because previously we showed that we will have at least k, and here we can show that we can have exactly k. We'll take this alphabet A, B, X, Y, and this word F, which has exactly two reducts, P and Q. And the important thing here is that P is a suffix of word Q. And if we take any infinite square free word over alphabet A, B, Y, but starting with the letter Y, we can create a sequence of prefixes, W1, W2, up to infinity. with strictly growing lengths, and we want each of them to end with y. We can show that this word, which is f, then w1, oh, something weird happened here. Okay, I will fix it later. Has exactly I plus one reducts. And here are those reducts. I think it's not worth to go into details with this proof, because it's just we just need to cover a lot of cases here to get a final result. The most important thing is that because word f ends and starts with x, and there is no x's in words w, and words w starts with y and ends in y, ends with y, and there are no y's in word f, then we can limit the possible squares that may occur. All the squares that exist in this word si are only inside at most, they are spanning over at most four blocks. So by block, I mean blocks F or blocks W. So we can have a square which is touching three occurrences of word F or three words W. It's not the case. We cannot do something like that. And if we dig a little bit into what's happening in there, we can see that there is a way to just reduce it to such smaller words, because if we take two words w, one of them is a prefix of another, because we are taking longer and longer prefixes. And just like I said, just a lot of cases. I'm not sure if it's worth to take a look into that. We can show such lemma. So if we have a square free word and we start to repeat those letters, right? So for example, if we have a square free words A, B, A, C, we can generate new words A, 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 B, 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 A, A, C, 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 which was created by repeating the letters. Then this kind of words can have only squares which are single letter up to the power of something even, right? Because we cannot have, for example, if we start with any word and we get an AA, BB, AA, BB, BB, or something like that, there can't be a square AA, BB, AA, BB. It's not the case. All the squares will contain only one type of letter. And the proof of that is pretty straightforward, because if we take a square of this word V and reduce all the letters, like if we have five letters A in the row, reduce it into one letter, but we are doing it for the first half and the second half, so in the end we will still get a square, then there are two cases. The first case is that this square starts and ends with the same letter, starts with different letters. So in this case, if they are starting with the different letters, we won't have this the only square of this the only square in this square would be this square. There won't be any for example, there won't be AA in that, but this this new word is a subword of word W, so it would mean that word W has a square, and if we if they are starting with the same letter and starting and ending with the same letter, then for example we have a let's take a look at the example. If we have ABA ABA, we can reduce this two A's in the middle to one A, so we will get AB ABA, and if we move a square one to the right to BA BA, this word would also have to be a subword of word W, and it would mean that word W has a square, which is not possible because word W is a square-free word. And yeah, we will use it for proving something like that. Okay. So yeah, let's take a word U over alphabet ABX, starting and ending with the letter X, and let alpha be R of U to the power. Again, some problem with formatting, to the power of 1 over U plus 5. Then there exists a constant C such that this function that I defined previously, so this growth rate of the number of reducts is at least C times alpha to the power of N. In the end, we will, I think maybe I will just quickly go through that. So yeah, we can take any infinite square free word over letters ABI, ABY, starting with letter Y. And we can repeat each occurrence of the letter Y. So we'll have in each place where there was a letter Y, right now we will have two letters Y, and we're splitting this word into chunks. So we are the borders of the chunks is are between those two letters Y, between every two letters Y. So we'll have the sequence of words, and each word has exactly two occurrences of Y, one at the beginning and one at the end. And then we can put words U between those chunks. And yeah, and we can show that if we take this word V J, which is which contains of J words U and J chunks T, then the number of redux of this word is at least the number of redux of word U to the power of J, and it's it is equal to this, and it's pretty straightforward because if we take a look at the word, all the reductions that we can do are in the words U, because if there would be any other square, and we'll would take the square, remove the letters which are parts of the blocks U, and go with only letters of the chunks T, then there can't be any square bigger than YY because of the previous lemma. So all the reductions we can do are inside the blocks U, and since U has the different reducts, we can reduce each of the blocks U to one of the D reducts, and in total we would get D to the power of J different Reacts. And also, the size of VJ is at most J times size length of U plus 5. It's because we are taking J blocks U, and after that we are taking also this chunks T, but each chunk has at most 5 letters. It's the same reason that I mentioned before, that between occurrences of the same letter, there are at most 3 different letters between them. In the end, we can just apply it to get that if we take the number of reducts of U and take it to the power of 1 over length of U plus 5, then we can use it as alpha. And also, yeah, it's the same thing that that is used in the second second inequality. So we can take C, okay, because obviously there are some, we are covering only the cases where the n is equal to j times length of u plus 5 for some j. And we have some cases in between in which we can, we have to add some dummy letters at the end, which doesn't, which are not giving us any new data, any new reducts or anything like that. So we can just ignore it and say that if we are in this, for these n's that are bad, we'll just add anything there and jump down to values of values for smaller words. And yeah, if we take the u equals to this one, which has exactly 4 reducts and length of it is equal to 13, then we may take alpha equal to 4 to the power of 1 over 14 plus 5, which means just 1 over 19, which is roughly 1.075, which is a little bit better than the alpha for the words over alphabet of size 3. And the last thing that I want to quickly talk about are that if we take an alphabet sigma and take all the all the words over this alphabet and relation of reduction, and then this pair is this pair forms a poset. And even if we take a really small poset, not like the like the smallest poset of this kind, so if we take only the alphabet of size 2, A and B and this relation, then this poset is universal. And yeah, proof of that is really, really straightforward. So if you would take a look at this thing, so if we take a word A, which is equal to A to the power of alpha 1, B, A to the power of alpha 2, B, A to the power of alpha n, and the word, the same, the really similar word B, but we are changing the exponentials to B, to beta, then we can reduce A to B if and only if all alphas are bigger, are not smaller than betas. And it's true because we cannot we cannot reduce any B because the number of letters B is the same in these two words. So we can do on, we can only do reductions inside the blocks inside the blocks which are containing only letters A, and each of this reduction is making the words shorter. So if any of this block is longer in word B than in word A, we cannot go this way, we cannot increase the number of A's. And yeah, just like I said, the proof is pretty straightforward because we can take a realizer R of poset B, if we take, and we can take the any element of poset P get the position of this element in all of the linear orders of R. So alpha A, alpha I of P is position of element P in if linear order of R. Then if we will map it to something like that, it's the same case as previously. We can see that any two elements P and Q can be reduced to one, can be reduced one to another after applying this mapping, only if these exponentials on the same positions are bigger in P than in Q, which would mean that for each linear order of realizer R, P is greater or equal than Q. And it's it obviously it means that P is greater or equal than Q in poset P. So we can show that. And the last result is that we can take this poset and ignore direction of the edges. And let's call it G of K. So G of K is like we can ignore that it's generated by poset. We can just take a look at it as that there are, we are taking all the words over alphabet of size K, and we are creating the edge between two, words, if and only if we can reduce one of them to another. And we can show that G3 has finitely many connected components, and this proof is also we also used a little bit of computation to prove that, but there are those three sets of words. It's the same thing as previously. It's not important to take a longer look at them, but there are some important facts about those words. So each square free ternary word of length at least 9 contains one of the words X up to alphabet permutation, of course, because you can see that all of these words starting with A and stuff like that. It was checked by the computer, we can reduce word SI to words XI and words YI. So XY and YI are in the same connected component. Obviously, just like we used it previously, if we can reduce only part of the word and everything works. So if A XY B, if S equal A XY B, then S is in the same connected component as A YI B, because X, Y, and Y, I are in the same component, so we can reduce word A S Y B towards A X Y B and A Y I B, which means that those two words are in the same connected component, and for each index, length of word X I is bigger than the length of YI. So if we have any word, we can reduce it to one of its reducts, take a look at it. If the length of this reduct is at most 8, then we are done. But if it's not, if the length of it is greater than 8, we can apply this this fact and get shorter word in the same connected component, which then we can reduce again, and we are repeating it as long as the reduct is bigger than the length of the reduct is bigger than 8. So in the end, we know that by repeating this operation, we can find a square free word of length at most 8 in each connected component. So there are at most that many connected components are as there are square free words of length at most 8, which is obviously finite. That's all. I will just bring some open questions that we come out during this during work on these problems. So just like I said, we know that we can generate we can have big numbers, we can have a ternary words with as many reducts as we want, but we don't want, if we can find it for exact k, with a word with exact k redux for each k. And we were doing some computation, and we found almost we found some words which has exact which have exactly k redux for k up to 120, except those few cases. So yeah, the first open question is if there are a ternary word W which has exactly 80 redux, because up to 80 we know that it's true for every k, but we didn't find anyone and any for k equal 80. And we have a conjecture which says that there exists infinitely many positive integers m such that no ternary word have exactly m distinct redux. The other one is similar to conjecture by Frankel and Simpson, which says that each word of length n has at most n distinct squares. So we want to propose something similar. So each word of length n can be square reduced in one step to at most n different words. Those two conjectures look pretty similar, but in reality they are pretty different, because we can reduce the same square in different positions of the word to obtain different words, but also we can reduce different squares different positions, obviously in the same word, and generate the same word, just like I showed you in the first example, where if we have A B, we can reduce A B or B A, and the result would be the same. And the last one is that we obviously showed that for k equal 3, this graph has infinitely many connected components. Obviously, it's also true for k equals 2, because each of them, because of the small set of square free words, and obviously also for k equals 1. But we don't know anything about this graph for k's bigger than 3. And the open question is if all of those graphs have infinitely many connected components. And yeah, and that's all. Do you have any questions?
Oh, thank you very much, Simon. We'll proceed to questions now. There is a question from Michelle Rigo in the chat. So he asks, on a given alphabet, do you know properties of the language made of words having exactly 1 or exactly k redux? Is it regular, context-free, etc.?
Mm-hmm. To be honest, I don't know. We haven't looked into that. Okay, but okay, I don't have any obvious answer right now for that question.
Okay, Maxime has a question.
Okay, do you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Hello, Simon. What do you know something about the situation when the redux contain only short squares? Is there something different in that case? I mean, if you eliminate by the redux only long squares, this is important from the algorithmic point of view.
And what do you mean by long?
Long. Longer, it depends, yes. You pick some threshold and that's it.
Okay, but you are picking the constant threshold or?
Yes, for instance, yes.
Okay, because, okay, I'm not sure if I understood the question right, but if we have any word which has, let's say we have a word of length n which has exactly m reducts, right? And if we apply any long square free morphism to this word, we'll obtain obviously a longer word, but let's say that this morphism is mapping each letter to a word of length, let's say 100, for example, right? Then we know that we can look only at the squares of length at least 200 and still obtain at least M reducts. I'm not sure if that's answer your question.
It's a kind of yes.
Okay.
Thanks. Arseny, do you have a question?
Yes. Actually, I have a comment. Shimon, if I'm not mistaken, that I know answers to both your conjectures, and maybe
okay.
Not on the windows. No. Okay. Yeah, the first, not about the Franklin Simpsons, of course.
this one?
The first conjecture, I think that you cannot have, have more than n reducts in one step. Yeah, so this was on the next slide. Yeah,
oh,
this
okay.
One. Mm-hmm. It seems that this follows from the theorems on runs. Because you have a runs theorem which says that there's less than n runs in a word, and if you make reduce mm-hmm. any square within a run, you will get the same result. You will get the same word.
Okay.
So you probably need to somehow operate with runs which have, which are longer than fourth power of a word, because uh-huh. In this case you can delete two or not just one period but two periods. Yes, but it seems that it's completely covered by the known results. Just check the paper about the Runge theorem by this Banai and other people from Japan. Probably this covers this
okay.
result. They also consider the situation with a long runs, and so probably you can just get the result you want. And consider your conjecture about GK.
Mm-hmm.
I should say that this is a theorem of from 1952.
Okay.
There is a very old paper by two founders of semigroup theory, Green and Rees. And the paper calls something, it's titled something like on semigroups satisfying x equal to x to the power of p.
Okay.
And they prove, so they prove a more general result. Mm-hmm. In fact, they consider the symmetric version of what you call reduction. Yes. So you can reduct, but you can also inflate. Mm-hmm. And then you have a congruence on semigroup. And they proved that if you have x equal to x squared, then you have always you have finite index. And they proved more general result for the case x equal to x to the power of p. They reduced that to a similar problem in groups.
Okay.
So that's a very old result, and they showed in the case x equal to x squared, they just show how these classes can be characterized. So just check this very old paper. And that is, thank you.
Cool, thanks.
Thank you, Arseny. Does anyone else have any questions? Okay, if not, thank you.